So let me take you back to about 3 years ago. It's September 2006, and if I had been standing here and told you that the United States was at risk of another Great Depression, you would have thought I was some kind of kook. Now, there were, of course, people who said that at the time, the people who predict the end of the world every 2 weeks and hope that someday they're right. But most people thought that was just something that was never going to happen again. If I'd stood here 2 years ago in September 2007, well, the world economy was looking a little shaky. We had discovered that housing prices don't only go up, they go down, at least everywhere except here. And the economy was beginning to quiver a little bit. But Ben Bernanke, then chairman of the Federal Reserve, and Hank Paulson, who was the Secretary of the Treasury, told us, and they were very deliberate in the choice of their words, that housing was contained, by which they meant we would have a housing bust, and people who owned houses might suffer a little bit, and people who lent money to people who owned houses might suffer a bit. But there were so many other good things going on in the American and the world economy that we were pretty much going to get through this without much pain. And it seemed a reasonable conclusion. After all, the one thing that we had learned over the last decade is that we have an extraordinarily resilient economy. We had been through the tech stock bubble with a minor recession. We'd shaken off the terror of 9/11, surely one of the biggest events in any of our lives, and yet the economy had come back. We'd had a couple of wars in Iraq. We had had the oil price spikes. We had had controversy over our democratic process. And yet, each time the economy kind of tripped and then came back. So there was no reason, they thought, why this should be any different. There were some hints, though, in 2007 that this might be a little bit different. The housing crisis had begun to affect the banking system, and the Fed had done what it usually does at times like this. It had turned the spigot on credit a little bit, hoping to compensate for the weakness of the banking system. But really, in 2007, it looked like we were going to get through it all okay. And then if you think where we were a year ago today, it's almost terror. We were closer to falling into another Great Depression at the end of September 2008 than we have ever been since the Depression, and frankly, I hope than we'll ever be again. And so the question is, how could this possibly have happened? How could something as robust as the American economy have fallen on such hard times? How could a nation which had convinced itself that, okay, maybe we don't make things as well as the Japanese, and maybe we don't make things as cheaply as they do in China or India or Mexico, but darn it, the one thing we know how to do in the United States of America is run a financial system. And we were giving advice to everybody else how they ought to run their financial system. And frankly, it doesn't look too good. The record doesn't look too good on that score, and I think we've learned some lessons. So what was happening at this time a year ago, let me take you back. Ben Bernanke, the chairman of the Fed, and Paulson had realized by early 2008 that the economy was worse than they had anticipated, and Bernanke had done very sharp interest rate reductions in January 2008, and they had been confronted with Bear Stearns. And that's when I started working on this book project. I was actually out here in July when John Taylor had a conference on this. And Bear Stearns, for someone who covered the Federal Reserve, was like the big event. The Fed, for the first time since the Depression, pulled the emergency cord and lent, if you will, or maybe bought, subsidized the purchase of Bear Stearns to the tune of $30 billion. Used the powers that Congress had given it after the Depression, during the Depression, to lend almost anybody in circumstances that the Fed deemed unusual and exigent. And they had lent to a bank, they had bought assets from a bank, in fact, for which they had no responsibility, no regulatory oversight, and they did it because they were convinced that had they let the bank go down, if they had not subsidized the purchase of Bear Stearns by J.P. Morgan Chase, we would have had an economic calamity. People weren't expecting it. So, in a sense, my book is the story of how Ben Bernanke found himself in this position. And let me take you back a little bit in time to who is Ben Bernanke anyways. One of the things that I conclude in this book, and I think it may be known here, but it's not widely appreciated in America, is just how few people are really involved in making the big decisions on something like that. I think most Americans think of the government as something like a platoon of bureaucrat after bureaucrat, where every decision is ratified by 57 people. But in my reporting on this crisis, it's actually a handful of people, you know, maybe no more than a dozen, fewer than a dozen, who are making all the big decisions, the ones that really matter. Supported, of course, by lots of people with bright ideas and lots of technicians, but the real fundamental decisions, if you made the list of 10 or 15 decisions that really mattered in the last year and a half, they were made by a very, very small number of people, and a lot of them were made by Ben Bernanke. So he had a great career at Harvard. He was a bright economics student, and he was then a graduate student at MIT in economics. And along the way, he became enamored with Milton Friedman's work and Anna Schwartz's on the Great Depression. And as many of you know, Milton Friedman had argued that the Depression was made worse by the fact that the Fed was stingy with credit, and that banks had failed because the Fed was stingy with credit. But to make a long story short, Bernanke thought that there was more to the story than that, and that the bank failures themselves made the Depression worse. And he spent a lot of time thinking about this, and it's a very interesting subject, and it's something like the economic equivalent of being a paleontologist. It's studying dinosaur bones, very interesting and totally irrelevant. And so he becomes chairman of the Federal Reserve. This academic has the great privilege of succeeding someone who George Bush called at Ben Bernanke's swearing in a rock star. And it's worth remembering, although I think Ben Bernanke is the hero of this story, that Alan Greenspan looked pretty much like a hero in 2006, and it doesn't look quite so good now. So it's worth remembering that I'm a journalist. I wrote a book about what was happening in real time, much more real time than I anticipated, thinking that the Bear Stearns was the big event. Shows you how prescient I was. I'm the guy who thought he could write a history of the Great Depression in 1931. And so Ben Bernanke becomes chairman of the Federal Reserve. And for his first year, he sets out to do two things. One, follow the policies of Alan Greenspan. He's quite explicit about that. Why change? Things seem to be going pretty well. And secondly, he sets out to be the un-Greenspan. He thought Greenspan's Fed was a little bit too much like the Vatican, an infallible pope at the top, and a bunch of people whose names you don't know. And he thought that wasn't healthy in a democracy, it wasn't good for the Fed, and so he set out to elevate the institution over the people, the committee over the chairman, and to be so open about what the Fed was thinking that no one would care when he gave a speech because there would be no new information in it. And for about a year, that's basically what he did. He spent a lot of time trying to get the Fed to be more systematic about its forecast of inflation, being very conscientious about reaching consensus, trying to mystify the role of the chairman of the Federal Reserve. And then he changed his mind. And he realized that when you get into an economic crisis, that the world does not want a dozen people speaking for the Federal Reserve. It doesn't want to have to rely on the Wall Street Journal to say that there are 10 guys you don't need to listen to and two that matter. And that committees have chairmen for a reason. And so you can see over this period how he begins to assert himself. First, he starts making speeches that set out the policy of the Fed with much more force than he had before. Secondly, he takes control of the committee, pushes this big interest rate in January 2008. And now we see the guy has gone well beyond anything Greenspan ever did. He's out there going over the heads of the press and over the heads of Congress, which is understandable. If you ever wanted to explain anything to the American people, doing it at a congressional hearing must be one of the most frustrating things in your life. And he's gone on 60 Minutes, he's gone on Jim Lehrer's NewsHour. I don't know if any of you saw the 60 Minutes thing. I thought the guy was going to declare for senator from South Carolina at the end of it. And in a sense, it was a re-election campaign. He got himself reappointed. But more, I think, he decided that he had to explain to the American people just why it was that the Fed had done what it had done. And in short, he said, sitting there on Main Street in Dillon, South Carolina, where his father's drugstore had been, and I was thinking, man, is he lucky that that wasn't called Wall Street or Bank Street. It wouldn't have made nearly as good TV. He said, I wanted to save Main Street. I didn't want to save Wall Street. I had to save Wall Street in order to save Main Street. And that, in short, is what he did, or what he set out to do.